This is 5.2, the definite integral and this section is just we're just going to build up a little bit of notation just to help make things easier for the next and final section. So what I'd like to do is as follows. I'd like to come up with some special notation for the limit as n goes to infinity of the sum as I goes from 1 to n of f of t sub I delta t. Again, what is this expressing for us? This is a right sum, and I'm taking more and more subintervals. So I'm literally having the number of subintervals approaching infinity. So what this is doing is this is actually giving me my true distance traveled. Now, if I take the number of subintervals and I have them approach infinity with a right sum, because I'm going from 1 to n, we also saw from last time that this should be the same thing as if I did a left sum. So again, this is a left sum. Now I'm starting from t sub 0, and I'm going up to t sub n minus 1. So these guys are the same thing, and I want some notation for both of them. And in particular, I'm going to use this notation. I'm going to write the integral as the integral from a to b of f of t dt. So this is read as the integral from a to b of f of t dt. So this is good notation. This is good notation because this integral sign almost looks like an S for sum. Looks like a kind of a continuous version of this thing. F of t dt, this looks like I'm multiplying my functional value, for example, the velocity, times dt. We've seen dt before when we talked about derivatives. Dt is an infinitesimal interval. Except I have to say, you're not actually multiplying. It's just part of the notation. So this is not f of t times dt. We can't divide out dt. It just looks that way. So this is the integral, and this integral is representing this limit. So what I'd like to do now is play around with this new notation so that we can get used to it. Because again, it's a lot cleaner than writing out all this stuff, and it's going to be needed in the next section. So a couple of examples. Let's find the integral from 0 to 2 of 6 dx. So what I'd like you to do now is actually pause the video and see if you can solve this question. And again, this is the same thing as this limit. Now you might say to yourself, well, that's crazy. How am I going to do that limit? Instead of thinking of it as a limit, remind yourself that this is giving me not just a total distance traveled, but it's also giving me a an area. So think of this in terms of an area where this is your function. So stop the video and give it a shot. All right, I'm sure you stopped the video and gave it a shot. So let's take a look at this. So what I'm going to do is graph this so I can see what's going on. A and B over here, remember we use those as representing the start of the interval and the end of the interval. So in this case, I'm going from 0 to 2. And my function is 6. So f of t equals 6. So literally, this is asking me for the distance traveled from here to here if I go 6 miles per hour. Well, we're going to stop thinking of it like that. We're going to start just thinking about it graphically. So another way to think about that is this is asking for the area under the curve f of t equals 6 from 0 to 2. And that we can do without using calculus. So 6 times 2 is just 12. So that integral is 12. Okay, let's try one that's a little bit more challenging. Let's try the integral from 0 to 2 of 3x dx. Again, I invite you to give this a shot. Pause the video before looking at the solution. And here's the solution. So same deal. This is actually asking to find the area under f of x equals 3x. So that's just a linear function through the origin from 0 to 2. So it's asking for the area represented by the shaded region. Well, this guy's just a triangle. And since this function is f of x equals 3x, when x is 2 over here, this height is going to be 6. 2 times 3 is 6. So to get this integral, again, which we're thinking about now in terms of the geometric area, it's just base times height divided by 2. So once again, we actually don't even need calculus to solve this particular problem. We'll get up to problems where we need calculus in the next section, but again, this is just to get us used to this notation. So as another more challenging example, let's try the integral from minus 1 to 1 of the square root of 1 minus x squared dx. So again, pause the video and give this one a shot. All right, so this is the function square root of 1 minus x squared. So the question becomes, what is that function graphically? Well, if we square both sides, we can see that y squared is equal to 1 minus x squared. Adding x squared to both sides, we get that x squared plus y squared equals 1. So this guy is actually just the top half of a circle, right? Because if I solved for y here, I'd get plus or minus the square root of 1 minus x squared. But it's just the top part of the circle. It's just the positive part. So let's take a look at that then. So I'm going from minus 1 to 1. And this guy's a circle with radius 1, and it's centered at the origin. So I guess I just need to know that the formula for the area of a circle is pi r squared. And since I just have half a circle, it'll be pi r squared divided by 2, or pi times 1 squared over 2. So up until now, I've talked about the idea that when we integrate things, when we're finding the total distance traveled, that what we're doing is we're finding the area under the curve. Well, that's not exactly correct. If the function is above the x-axis, then yes, that's what we're doing. But if the function is not above the x-axis, we need another way of interpreting it. And that's what we'll see in this next example. So let's say I wanted to find this integral. Once again, I invite you to try it, give it a shot before looking at the answer. So pause the video. All right, so let's take a graph. Let's take a look at this graph. So this is f of x equals x, which looks like this, and I want the integral from minus 2 to 2. So it looks like I want this shaded region. Well, how do we make sense of this since our function is below the axis there? Well, this is where we have to realize what this is. Once again, it's the limit as n goes to infinity of the sum as I goes from 1 to n of f of, I'm now going to use x's x sub I delta x. So I'm just using x's instead of t's. So what this is doing is we're adding up these products. Well, if you look at your rectangles, say we have a rectangle over here, we've got an analogous rectangle over here, except the f of x sub I over here is negative. The f of x sub I here is positive. So what's happening is when we add up all of those rectangles, we're actually adding up the actual areas on this side. But on this side, we're adding up the opposite of the areas, since my f of x values are negative. So they're going to cancel each other out, and this integral is going to be 0. So with this in mind, we can no longer think of the integral or this limit as just being the area. Because if I had just integrated from negative 2 to 0, all of these f of x values are negative on this side, and this limit would have been a negative number, and areas aren't negative. So instead of talking about an area, we talk about a net area or a signed area. So in general then, the integral from a to b of f of x dx is the net or signed area over the x-axis from a to b. So again, if my function happens to be positive, it'll give me the area. If the function is partially negative, maybe I'll get a negative value, maybe I'll get 0, I might get a positive value, and I would get a positive value if there's more positive stuff than negative stuff. Converting this same question, let me just write t, so we're thinking velocity. Let me change this into a velocity question. Let's see how we can interpret this. So this is telling me that if I integrate this, I'm getting 0 out, which seems a little bit weird for my total distance traveled. So let's think about what's happening in terms of velocities and direction and all that stuff. So this is my velocity function. My velocity is negative here. So that means that the distance function must be going backwards, must be decreasing, right? Because the velocity is the derivative of the distance function. So what you could think about here then, what you could think about is that from negative 1 to 1, I'm traveling backwards. And then, from negative 1 to 0, I'm traveling backwards. And then from 0 to 1, I go the other way. So instead of, and I'm getting out 0. So what is the 0 representing? It's not total distance traveled. It's what they would call in physics displacement. So we could then think of this in general as representing the displacement of an object. Again, if this guy happened to be positive the whole way through, then yes, it would have given us a total distance. But if we have values that are both positive and negative, then we're talking about a particle moving both forward and backwards, and then we're talking about the displacement of it.